Rahman Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. We are greatly honored to receive in our studio this morning the Sheikh Al Azhar, Imam Al Akbar, Dr. Tantawi. The Sheikh Al Akbar has a great responsibility, not only as head of the oldest Islamic institution for education, but the whole Muslim Ummah looks towards you as a leader of thought and action. We welcome you in Pakistan. How you look on the global phenomena which exists in terms of the dialogue going on between Islam and other civilizations? We are entering a new age, a new century. How do you look Muslim or Islamic position, particularly role of Al-Azhar, in this global dialogue which has emerged on the surface of history?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يسعدني أولا أن أتقدم بخالص الشكر.
I am very great honor to the Prime Minister of Pakistan, Mr. Nazir Bhutto, which has been invited me to visit our brother Pakistan country. كما أن مصر as well as Egypt, its president, government and the people convey their greetings to our Pakistan people to cooperate in each field in the right way. We know the life is developing from one day to day, from one week to week, from month to month, from year to year, from generation to generation. Its development in all the fields, agricultural, industrial, and all other sectors. But there is some facts and ethics cannot be exchanged or grow up. For example, the faith, it can't be accept development. Because the main message of all the prophets of Allah is to call his people to worship Allah Almighty. There is no God but him. The good morals cannot also know development. For example, the truth and the honesty and dignity and prosperity be in every generation, in the past, like in the current, like in the future. We can grow up it. And the vice also, it is the same in the past and the current and the future. And the people cannot dispense to cooperate between each other. Because everybody needs his other brother by sinning and selling and buying and other kinds of transactions. If this dialogue in the past was very limited due to lack of transport and communication, the dialogue nowadays is required. Because all this world has become like a small village. We as a Muslim, we say welcome to any dialogue. Which kind of dialogue we welcome it? This dialogue which is based on truth, which is based on subjectivity. The dialogue which is based on just, not on the injustice. The justice which is based on piety, not on the evil. Dialogue which has done by the people to lead them to the truth. If this dialogue is going to be based on this limits, good morals, we say welcome and we encourage it. The Holy Quran has been said many evidence for this dialogue. The Quran has been narrated a dialogue between Allah Almighty and Iblis. We can find that in Surah Al-A'raf and Surah Al-Hijr and all other verses and the surahs in Quran. Allah Almighty said to Iblis, O Iblis, why don't you prostrate before Adam? Iblis said, O my God, you created him from the mud, the clay, but you created me from the fire. So from his point of view, he is better than him. By this, the Holy Quran has been mentioned to us one example, like the others, for the dialogue between Allah Almighty and the Iblis who refused and who denied to be restored before Adam at the time of creation. Holy Quran also narrated some examples of dialogues between the prophets and their nations. The Holy Quran has been mentioned to us dialogue between the Prophet Muhammad and his people regarding the resurrection day and the day of judgment. Also, Holy Quran has mentioned to us some dialogues between Allah Almighty and his honorable messengers.
We greatly appreciate what you have informed us about this remarkable phenomenon in the Quran. But the dialogue we have today has different levels. And we would like to hear particularly, how do you look toward the consumerism of ideas we have? Muslim world today appears a matter of consumer of ideas, whatever comes from the West, we take it and circulate it. in this dialogue, do we have something which is superior to offer to the West, intellectually, economically, culturally, politically? Then we can have a dialogue. The dialogue between the prophets and the people of their nations were that they have come from a superior level. They offer something higher. How do you look on this phenomena today?
We have some values, morals. Islam has then brought us up. So we make dialogue with them to lead us to the truth and exchange of the benefits between the nations. Islam has been affirmed it and encouraged it. As long as this intellectual exchange in the limited of the Islam welcome to it, it's lawful. There is no harm for the West to take what is the benefit them from the East. And there is no harm for the East to take what the benefit them from the West. All what can help us as a Muslims, there is no harm to take it from the East, from the West. There is no harm for Muslims to take the arts of agriculture, industry, and the science in the limited what Allah and Sharia has been told us. As you know, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, has been told and advised our master and companion, Sayyidina Zayd, to learn the Hebrew language. He spoke the first language in 15 languages and the other language in 17 days. The Prophet Muhammad didn't say, don't learn this language because it is not Arabic language. But he make obligatory for him to learn those two languages because there is some benefits to learn it and there is no any harm to learn. It has been mentioned that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, sent some of his companions to the country of his enemies to learn the arts of wars and other arts. Although they are his enemy, he didn't object to send him to this country to learn their language and their arts. It has been mentioned that Abu companion of Abu Bakr, when he sent the companions Khalid ibn Walid to fight some of enemies of Islam, he advised him before starting the battle, if they fight you by sword, fight them by sword. And if they fight you with spear, fight him with spear. And if Abu Bakr alive nowadays and he discovered there is aeroplane and the nuclear bomb, he will advise him to wage the war by nuclear bomb as they are launch war against him by this way. To sum up the science he has the home. We learn from science of the other which benefit us, and the others learn from us because they help them.
No doubt I fully agree with you. Your extremely important elaboration has brought to us two aspects. Firstly, there is no problem for Muslims in learning arts and sciences of others.
Yeah.
The question is, when we learn these arts and sciences, is it learning or is it the yearning for excellence? When we excel in those arts and sciences, only then we will be able to have a dialogue. Secondly, when we are in this new world situation where the polar balance has been disturbed, what do you see the role of Al-Azhar, Muslim intellectuals and institutions in offering an excellent qualitative approach where we go beyond what the West is doing? Unless we take that approach, we cannot face the new century. So the dialogue is not confined to a discussion, but it's a matter of how we can excel over others. Secondly, how we can offer something which is superior, and only then we can have an exchange of ideas and know-how in the free market of ideas.
We said the nation all the time in developing. And as the wisdom said, take the excellence from any place has been done. As you know, the main function of Al-Azhar in this approach to clarify to the people, to the nation of Islam, the rule of Sharia. As you know, Sharia of Islam, Sharia Islam legislation, calls the people to worship Allah Almighty only, and calls the people to perform the worshiping which purifies their hearts and purifies the hearts of the people from envy and killing and make any bad things against other nations and other people. It calls them to adhere with peace, love, and all the good cooperation between all of them. It calls them to exchange the benefits among each other, which prosperity and welfare will prevail, and which peace and security will. It calls them to adhere with the good morals and avoid the bad. And an Azhar which lasted more than 1,000 years ago is very careful about this law.
How do you see the religious and cultural context in Pakistan and Egypt? How do you see possible venues of collaboration in order to bring better peace, better understanding, upliftment of Muslim community? Okay. And also, if you kindly give a brief comment on how the future challenge of communication that has brought us so closer is to be addressed by Muslims.
Al-Azhar yaqumu.
From the ancient time, Al-Azhar is very keen to perform his function in proper way. For example, the cooperation between Al-Azhar and the Pakistanian is very, very high. For example, there is a lot of students are studying in Al-Azhar, and even there is some professors who are teaching in Egypt also. And even me, I am supervisor of one of Pakistani students in Al-Azhar. Regarding the cooperation between Al-Azhar and the Pakistanian, it is very highest moving forward, and it is very, very in good way now. And inshallah, if it believes of Allah Almighty, it will develop more and more in the future. Yesterday, I inspected Al-Azhar Institute here in Islamabad, and I was very glad to see a certain children, maybe in the grade 1, grade 2 primary school, are memorizing all the Holy Quran. That's fantastic. That is opening the heart and tithing our hearts as a Muslim. Those who are educating them, a great number of Al-Azhar scholars. Yesterday also I inspected Islamic University here in Islamabad, and I found a great number of professors of Al-Azhar are educating their poets and their children here in this college. We have strong belief to strengthen the cooperation between Al-Azhar and Al-Azhar, Egypt and Pakistanian in all the fields, intellectually, religiously, socially, and all other fields. We believe this cooperation is obligatory between two nations, Egypt and Pakistanian, because Prophet Muhammad said, example of the Muslim to his other towards his other Muslim, like bricks, building of the bricks of the building, strengthening each other. We believe that this era regime in Egypt and in Pakistan nowadays, it is the best time to strengthen this cooperation.
We are extremely grateful to the Honorable Sheikh Al-Azhar, Imam Al-Akbar, Dr. Tantawi, for your very kind elaborations on these various aspects. You have very correctly pointed out that Islam is a matter of tolerance. Islam is a matter of accepting whatever is permissible in Islamic framework. However, Islam is also a matter of taking over from that point, reaching excellence, producing knowledge and ideas, offering these ideas to others, not confined to one single area. The future challenge of the century is not simply a matter of a language to be used between two nations and culture and civilizations, but it's a matter of the free trade of ideas. In this free market of ideas, if we don't produce original ideas, if we don't come up with a better solution than what exists in the market, then we'll not be able to continue dialogue. To have a dialogue, as you kindly mentioned, we have to produce new ideas. We have to take those with all humbleness, with all humility, and the worth of ideas will, inshallah, set the tone of the century. We again thank you very much for your kind visit of Pakistan. We are honored to have you here. We are also thankful to you for your observations and for your friendly gestures and your dua to bring not only Pakistan and Egypt together, but the whole Muslim Ummah, so we can present Islam through our actions, through our economy, through our political life, through our society, and that apparent, vibrant presence of Islam will be the basis for the new century, for the new dialogue, for the meaningful coexistence and supremacy of Islam ultimately. We thank you again, and we hope, inshallah, you'll visit Pakistan again and again. We want to benefit from your presence, from your knowledge, from your experience, and we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you a long life and a safe journey back to Egypt. Thank you very much.
Gives me a pleasure to thank you, to thank Palestinian people, its president, its prime minister, government, and all the people for this kind visit. And inshallah almighty, I pray to Allah almighty to safeguard you with peace and security and all the welfare in your country.